In a moment, I'm going to introduce you to a multi-talented brilliance. What if I told you there's a person who has read just about every medical textbook and journal out there and uses that knowledge to diagnose medical mysteries, but also has collaborated as a fashion designer on a dress that was worn by a supermodel at the Met Gala, has helped produce the movie trailer for a major feature film. Oh, by the way, is also a published cookbook author, has a budding career as a weather forecaster, and did I mention, won a huge tournament on Jeopardy, even beating Ken Jennings. That last part might have been the giveaway. I am not actually talking about a person, but a machine. Meet Watson, IBM's tech platform that uses artificial intelligence and machine learning in extraordinary ways. That list of Watson's accomplishments actually scares many who worry that computers are now powerful enough to do almost any human job. I went down to IBM's Watson Center in downtown Manhattan to talk about it all with IBM's chairman, president, and CEO, Ginni Rometty, who is also a multi-talented brilliance. IBM is, of course, one of the world's largest companies with a market cap over $140 billion. Welcome, Ginni Rometty.
Thank you, Fried. Nice to be here with you again.
Explain to us the road to Watson. How did we get here? What is happening in technology that led to this?
This is a great question, and it speaks a lot to what I think everyone is experiencing around the world, either personally or in a business. You know, there have been three big technology trends, I think, shaping our lives. One, cloud, mobility, and then all this explosion of data around us. You have this explosion of information. It is impossible to understand it. And this was the road to Watson. We saw this long ago, that there'd be all this data, but for it to really bring any value to business or to the world to solve these unsolvable problems, you were gonna need a whole new way of computing, of systems that could take that and make some sense out of it. You know, if you just think about, go back 20 years and retail. If you were online buying something, you were a typical retailer, not typical, a big one, you might have had 500,000 things you could look at. Today, 20, 25 million. So as you as a buyer, how could you even discern what is the right thing to do? And that's just one small example. So this is what has led us to Watson, this idea that this explosion of information, and that once you become digital, you're gonna need some way, data is gonna differentiate companies then, and how do you make sense of it? That led us to this world, which was Watson, which is basically, think of it as the ability for systems to learn.
How is Watson different from your average computer?
It's very different, and I want you to not think of it as a computer. Think of Watson in this new world of cognitive. Think of it as it's in the cloud, so therefore it's applicable to everyone, and think of it as being embedded in everything that you could do. So it'll impact your daily life, it'll impact your business. And so when you think of it that way, think of it as a service that could be embedded, it'll touch billions of things, billions of people, and billions of things that they do, basically to help you make a better decision, whether that's personally or whether that's professionally.
So let's take medical, because Watson does a lot of medical work. Explain to us why Watson is a better doctor than most doctors.
I wouldn't say it that way. What I really envision, and this is an important point about cognitive, its goal is not to replace anyone. In fact, it's really been our goal. It's been about not artificial intelligence, it's about augmenting intelligence and helping people make better decisions. And that's in fact what we're doing. And so, you know, I mentioned we do work, and I see this era doing work for both what you would call everyday decisions, as well as what I would call solving the unsolvable. And you mentioned healthcare.
But let's take a diagnosis.
Yes, so here's how it would go with the diagnosis. So cancer, the Cancer Oncology Advisor is rolling out, been developed, and Watson's been taught by some of the best institutions in the world, Memorial Sloan Kettering, the Cancer Center here in New York, but as well work we've done with Cleveland Clinic, Mayo Clinic, MD Anderson, clinics abroad, systems abroad. So what a doctor would do to assist, Watson will have been able and has read all the literature on cancer, all the journals, all the texts, your EMR, your medical record, which could be hundreds of pages long, your tests. And what it's gonna do, when I said it can understand and reason, just like you and I, forms hypotheses, checks against all the data, knows what percent confidence, and then shows a doctor, these are the different kinds of ideas around what the diagnosis is and the appropriate treatment.
But the key difference is, correct me if I'm wrong, because you showed this to me once, a doctor can hold maybe a couple hundred articles in his or her head.
That's right.
And Watson is looking at 2 million articles.
We're over, well over millions and millions now.
But let's be honest, presumably with access to millions of articles and that much data, Watson must make better diagnoses than an average doctor.
It's going to help an average doctor, absolutely. And that is really the point, because you won't necessarily be able to see a world-class oncologist, but your oncologist or your general doctor is going to have that access to help them do their job. And then they actually can do what we want our doctors to do. They spend time with you in understanding you. I mean, an average doctor visit, as you know, can be a very small period of time. And so that's why I say this is really a world where it's going to augment what professionals do and what each of us do.
Now, in the movie business, the art of making the trailer is seen as a very soft skill. It's something you have to do appreciating what an audience will like, how it'll evoke certain emotions. So a successful movie trailer has often been seen as a very fine art skill that an editor puts together. And yet Watson was able to do this thing that the human does in, it would take months apparently to cut a movie trailer, and Watson sort of did it in a day. Explain how.
Well, actually, Watson helped the film editor do this in a day, something that would have taken him weeks to do. And this has been an element in one pathway we've worked on, which is creativity. And so, in fact, what Watson's doing is watching different movies and watching then how people respond and what is it they're responding to, and then looking for in this movie what are the elements that would duplicate that, and then giving that input to the person putting together the trailer to have them then put together the most popular trailer that's going to get and elicit the right audience behavior from that. So it's very much that idea of these systems can learn, and they're learning by observation, reaction, knowing how people's brains work, how their emotions react, and puts all that together.
So what it suggests is that all these things we think of as creativity
can
it can also be broken down, digitized, and coded so that a computer can understand them?
In many ways they can be. And that's, I know people think of things like smell and taste, but actually, or even the way you react when maybe you smell something that you remember from your childhood, it brings back. These are all chemical, can be broken down into chemical equations. And in fact, by doing that then, you can come up with better recommendations. I mean, we're doing work with Campbell Soup about, you know, how to prepare the right recipe and remind you of when you were young, that kind of thing. And they can be broken into equations and digitized.